Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'll share my screen. And yes. Do you all see my screen? And do you all hear me?
Yes, yes.
Okay, yes, we hear you.
Okay, thank you. This is, I think, also for you an important session. And I would like to propose that I explain the trial and that we have a discussion at the end, a long discussion that might be. And if you have an urgent question in the middle, that would be fine. But the thing is that I might also touch on the subject later on. So I would say if it can wait, then keep it till the end. So we are going to talk about the Guanabens trial. And I would first like to briefly discuss again why Guanabens, because some of the people might not have been there this earlier this day. And so we start with the molecular mechanisms of vanishing white matter. As you know, the defect in vanishing white matter is in this 5-subunit enzyme, EIF2B. And EIF2B is in the heart of biology because it's in translating genes, DNA, into proteins. So how deep in biology can you get? If there would be no EIF2B, there would be no life. In vanishing white matter patients, there are mutations in this vector. And that means that the activity of the enzyme is decreased. But it cannot be zero, because otherwise there would be no protein production and there would be no life. So there's always remaining activity. That's one function of EIF2B. The second function is it regulates how much protein is produced. So if it is very active, lots of protein is produced. And if it's inactive, protein synthesis is down. And with that, it's also in the heart of the cellular stress response. If the body is in stress, the cellular stress response is activated. And what I don't mean by stress is that your mother is mad at you and is yelling at you because you did something wrong. What I mean is physical stresses like fever, infections, head trauma, starvation, things like that. That's a stress for the body. And in those situations, protein synthesis needs to be shut down because cells have to decide whether they are going to survive the stress or going to die in the stress. And this is an energy consuming process. Now, protein synthesis is also an energy-consuming process, so that temporarily has to be down-regulated. And that's done by EIF2B. This is a representation, a complex representation of the stress response. And what you see here is stresses. This is a viral infection. This is heme deficiency. This is fever, febrile infection, amino acid starvation. All these stresses activate enzymes. And these enzymes lead to the phosphorylation of another initiation factor, EIF2, that then tightly binds EIF2B, downregulates it, and that has two consequences. One is a decrease in general protein synthesis. I just explained that to you. And the second thing is activation of the AGF4 response. And that's a very complex response with numerous factors. And these factors are going to decide whether the cell is going to recover or whether the cell is going to die. Now, in vanishing white matter, EIF2B activity is always down because of the mutations. I told you that mutations decrease its activity. General protein synthesis is still preserved. I also said that to you that there can be no life if this would not be guaranteed. But the AGF4 transcription response is activated always in vanishing white matter because EIF2B activity is down. That means that the downstream response is always activated. So these components are high. And so the cells are always being pushed into, are you going to recover or are you going to die? And this specifically happens in brain white matter cells. We don't know why that is, but it specifically happens in brain white matter cells. I also discussed earlier today the therapy targets, and today we'll only talk about option D. Can we target one of the downstream factors in the AT4 response, which is GUT34, and GUT34 is the entry of a feedback loop that abates the cell stress. Can we target GUT34 to work on the activity of EIF2B? Now, guanabens is a drug that works on GUT34. It's a very old drug. It was coming onto the market at the end of the 70s, so it has been around for a long time, and it sort of fell off the market around 2010, when there were, you know, better antihypertensive drugs. It has FDA and EMA approval, and because it's known for so long time, it's safe in chronic use. It has been used in patients from the age of 12 years on. It has no long-term adverse effects, but it does have side effects. It's not that it is a drug without side effects. The most frequent side effect is drowsiness. Less common side effects are dry mouth, drop in blood temperature, dizziness because of the low blood pressure, and headaches. And the drop in blood temperature is because the thermostat is set at a lower temperature level. These side effects are dose dependent, and there is rapid tolerance. So they wear off. The ISR target is GUT34, but what you have to realize is the affinity for GUT34 is lower than for the alpha-2 adrenergic receptor. So if you want to target GUT34, the alpha-2 adrenergic side effects are inevitable. So they are present. And it has an ameliorating effect in mouse models and with neurodegenerative disease with abnormal ISR activation. And that's why we tried it in our Vanishing White Matter mice. And as I showed you this morning, we saw significant amelioration. This is the neuroscore, and the neuroscore is more abnormal if higher. So this is the untreated Vanishing White Matter mouse in black. And you can see the rise of the neuroscore. This is the same mouse, also the Vanishing White Matter mouse treated once a week. And this is the mouse treated daily. So the daily treated mouse does best. A normal mouse does not slip on the balance beam. The Vanishing White Matter mouse slips a lot. And what you see that with weekly treatment and most of all with daily treatment, the motor performance on the balance beam becomes much better. The speed with which the balance beam is crossed is low in normal mice. It's high in untreated Vanishing White Matter mice, and with guanabens, you can see it's lower. This is with the weekly treatment, and this is with the daily treatment. Also, on a brain level, we see improvement of white matter pathology, and we also see decrease in ISR activation in the brain white matter. So that looks good. In mice, sedation and lower body temperature are the only side effects, and they are we see tolerance actually in a matter of days. So the first day we see the biggest effect, so they drop, they fall asleep immediately. And the second day that doesn't happen anymore. And also this doesn't come back. So the tolerance is fast. So that means that guanabens is highly promising in Vanishing White Matter. Because it's such an old and safe drug, you know, we can skip a lot of steps that you have to take for new drugs. So we decided a couple of years ago to set up a therapeutic trial for guanabens in Vanishing White Matter patients. Now, Vanishing White Matter is not an easy disease to work on because it's extremely variable and unreliable. So what you see is the earlier the age of onset, the more rapid the disease, but with later onset, you can see that some patients deteriorate fast, and minus 0.5 is death. But you also see that even with an onset between 2 and 4, patients may live till 40 years. Whereas patients with a late onset, you know, may have a similar survival. So that means that it's a very difficult disease to work with. And that's why I have also been thinking and talking to a lot of people about this, because my biggest fear is to miss a therapeutic effect because of an inadequate trial. And that is the reason why we set up strict criteria for inclusion and setup. Because if there is a beneficial effect of guanabans, I really don't want to miss it because the trial setup was wrong or, you know, not good enough. I'm going to discuss with you a few points about the disease. Early onset disease is dominated by motor decline. You can see that here. Whereas late onset disease is dominated by cognitive decline. That's the green line. And that means that it might be needed to do separate trials or separate trial arms for early and late onset disease because the disease is so different. What you also have to realize is that long-standing brain damage is irreversible. So if a patient has been in a wheelchair for a couple of years, it's never going to go back. That's not how the brain works. The brain is not good in repair. And that means that if you try this drug in patients with long-standing damage, you'll not see an effect. But that's not because the drug is not working. That's because the damage is irreversible. And that means that for this reason, it's very important to focus on patients early in the disease. If you don't do that, you will miss a potential effect. The other thing is that the disease course is more predictable for early than for late onsets. As you can see here, that the disease course is more predictable the earlier the onset. And that means that talking to this morning, you saw Peter van der Ven, who's my trial statistician, and he said you can match with historical controls, but only for the early onset cases. Because for the later onset cases, the disease is so variable that it is not possible. And also because it's slower, he would advise a double-blind control trial. Because of the highly variable disease course, there are also two other things. One is small and very short trials are unlikely to go going to be informative. So sometimes people think you can do a trial of 1 year, you know, with 1 year, and you look at this variable disease course, you're not going to find an effect. So a trial needs to be a couple of years. And also because the disease is so variable, we are not aiming for subtle effects. I'm not going to show subtle effects. We have to aim for substantial effects, effects that are big enough to show it in a limited number of patients. Like for multiple sclerosis, there are a zillion patients. So you can aim for small effects. There are not a zillion vanishing white matter patients. So we have to aim for substantial effects. This is the first trial, phase 1-2 trial. And you will say phase 1 means safety. And in the Netherlands, we have to go to a central committee for such trials. The committee is called the CCMO. And that's a central committee that decides on trials for patients who cannot decide for themselves. And that means trials for children and trials for elderly demented people. And because guanabans has not been applied in children below the age of 12, we still have to look at safety for those children. I'm not worried about it, but we have to. But we are, of course, mostly interested in the two part because that's about efficacy. We have set up an international but monocenter trial in Amsterdam. Safety, as I said, is the primary outcome. Efficacy is the secondary outcome. And the central committee has allowed us to include 30 patients. And as you were expecting, because of my introduction, we go for early onset, relatively early onset, onset below the age of 6, and patients need to be still able to walk. I'm coming back to that later. So we go for the more rapid disease course to try to shorten the trial. We go for the predictable part of the disease so that matching with historical controls is possible and the placebo group can be avoided, because I would feel to have a placebo group for very, very young patients, that would not be ethical, because being in the placebo group for 2 years, you know, you could become, a child could become very handicapped. We also go for still walking patients to avoid too much irreversible brain damage. As I said, this trial has been approved by the National Committee. We have acquired funding. The ELA has provided funding. The Dutch Brain Foundation has provided funding. This is the Dutch NIH has provided funding. And also the Vanishing White Matter Family Foundation, so the Vanishing White Matter Foundation and the Vanishing White Matter Foundation, Family Foundation, have committed to provide funds, and we have private donations. The start of the trial has been June 1. So the first three patients have been selected, and after evaluation of all details, the trial will be restarted. So we have the first two patients in Amsterdam. These are the practical details. So 30 patients, onset below 6, still able to walk 10 steps with no or light support of one hand. This is a criterion coming from the GMFM, which is a scale. And so this comes with strict criteria about how much the support might be. And a physical therapist is looking to that. The maximum disease duration may be 8 years. And patients need to live at reasonable travel distance from Amsterdam. With the fact that people only have to come once a year in Amsterdam, apart from the 3-month visit, but after that only once a year, we feel that North America is also reasonable travel distance. During the first visit, titration will be done to the maximum tolerated guanabens dose. And this takes time because I told you it's a serious drug. So the blood pressure will drop, there will be sedation, and that every step to increase the dose takes two or three days. So patients are there for a while to titrate to the maximum tolerated guanabens dose. And we give it in a single dose before sleep to avoid daytime drowsiness. And so the first two patients are there. And what we see now already is that titration is really important to maximize the dose. And if you do it slowly, then you can build it up. So that works well. After having been titrated to the maximum tolerated dose, patients can go home. And every 3 months, there will be a video interview and assessment. And parents, or they need to contact their local physician, need to do a finger prick to obtain a blood spot and send it to Amsterdam so that we can assess the guanabens level. Annually, patients come to Amsterdam. There will be a clinical neurological examination. We will look at motor and cognitive tests, and there will be an MRI under light anesthesia. And we use an anesthetic that we think is safe, and we have never seen a deterioration with anesthetic. And under anesthesia, we do repeated blood for PK, safety lab, and also to acquire information on biomarkers. Patients enter the trial now already, and all patients will stay in the trial until the last patient has been followed for 1 year. The trial will probably take with that 4 years. I'm also worried about making the trial shorter because I'm most of all worried that we'll miss an effect that's there. So I'm counting on 4 years. Regarding the trial, the following answers will be given. We will know about safety, tolerability, and pharmacokinetics of guanabens, and we'll see major effects, not subtle effects. The trial will also yield essential data for new trials, like clinical scores, blood and CSF biomarkers, and MRI biomarkers. And this trial has been registered, and this is the website at which the trial has been registered. This is the trial team. So this is the trial coordinator, Marije Voermans. She's an essential person. Then this is our central trial nurse. We have another trial nurse, Kirsten. This is Claire. And Menno is managing the registry. Renate Verbeek is de sub-I en Nicole Wolf is involved. And I'm not seeing a person who's currently helping with the trial. That's Elske van den Berg. And then we have pharmacists helping and also people in the laboratory. The future plan is, we have made ourselves ready for if it works. The Amsterdam UMC has submitted a patent for the application of guanabenzene phenacetin white matter, and we are several rounds further. It's not yet been approved, but it looks like it might be approved. And if guanabenzene ameliorates phenacetin white matter, we aim at its registration for phenacetin white matter. And the final aim is to make the drug available to phenacetin white matter patients at cost price. So we want to make no profit, but we want to make it available at cost price. And the Amsterdam UMC will facilitate this. I certainly understand that this trial comes with limitation. The trial aims at decisive trial results. We want to know, does guanabenzene have a beneficial effect or not at a dose that's well tolerated? And the trial aims at results as fast as possible. That means that we are going for young children and we aim at knowing that there really whether there's a beneficial effect. And that means that we have determined the inclusion criteria to go for that. So we go for the most homogeneous part of the disease, the best predictable part of the disease, and the likely reversible part of the disease. And this can be done because guanabenzene is such an old drug. In the Netherlands, this could not be done for a new drug because we are not allowed to test new drugs in patients under 16 if there's no other evidence that it might be working. So that means what I understand, and this is extremely painful, that many phenacetin white matter patients are not eligible for this trial. And I'm happy to talk with you about it, but The other thing is that the burden for participating families is considerable. I'm also seeing that. They have to come to Amsterdam regularly. There are these three monthly video visits. They have to fill in weekly questionnaires and diaries, and there have to be a finger prick every 3 months. So this is not an easy and light trial. It's a tough trial. So it's a collaborative effort of the Phenacetin White Matter community and the Phenacetin White Matter Consortium and us to achieve treatment for Phenacetin White Matter. This is about the governance of the guanabenzene trial. So the Dutch National Ethics Committee has approved the trial. The Amsterdam UMC approved the local execution of the trial. We have a monitor in place, the Data Safety Monitoring Board. The Phenacetin White Matter Consortium is involved, it contributes patients, it monitors the trial results and looks at the setup of possible parallel trials. Sorry for my clocks. Additionally, we have a committee in the Netherlands to monitor trial progress and contribute to implementation of its results. This is obligatory, so patients, families and organizations are involved. Pediatric neurologists and implementation experts who know about how to get the drug registered and how to implement the results. And we have an international forum of patients and family organizations as interface between the trial organization and patients and their families. And also here, multiple organizations are involved, the ILA with Guy Alba and Elise Saunier. The Phenacetin White Matter Foundation and the Phenacetin White Matter Family Foundations. So Brett Holberg and Allison and Nick Buck. The ULF, and I would like to mention Donna Squirat. And the VKS, which is a Dutch organization, has been very helpful for the trial, which is Hanka Dekker. And then what patients and families can do is make sure that all patients are known. It helps very much if as many patients as possible are in the registry. Participate in natural history studies, that's also very helpful. Help identify eligible patients and help raise money, and you already do that. And I think I stop sharing my PowerPoint in order for all of you to be able to participate in the discussion. Is there anybody who wants to ask something or say something?
Dr. Vandernep, there is one question in the chat. So do you want me to read it now or did you see
Yes, can you do that? No, I did. I can see. Yes, I can see it yet. Oh, my daughter has R2 leukodystrophy. Yes, which has similar characteristics to vanishing white matter. Do you think that guanabans could help in other leukodystrophy conditions? And the answer is no. Guanabans would do nothing for R2 leukodystrophy. It's specific for if something is wrong with the integrated stress response. I think there's a session on R2 later tonight.
And Dr. Vandernep, there's another question. It says, I found another patient for you also in Moscow, Russia.
Okay, I recognize the name of the father, and so email us. That would be wonderful.
Yeah, Maria, I've already got my doctor contacting you via email. I know that you're very busy now getting ready for the committee and for this foundation meeting. So just look through your email. You've got email from my doctor.
Okay, that's good.
Got another girl for you.
Yeah. That's good.
Hi, doctor. I'm from South Africa. I'm Hailey's mother.
Hello.
Hello, doctor.
How are you?
The people in South Africa don't know about vanishing white matter disease and that. So, yeah.
The doctors don't know about vanishing white matter disease?
Nope.
That's not good.
No, not at all.
No. I know several pediatric neurologists in South Africa. And have you been to a big hospital where any pediatric neurologists work? Because I'm pretty sure they know about the disease.
What's the Red Cross? Yeah, the Red Cross Hospital, but nothing. Mm-mm.
Well, what as I discussed this this morning, what we'll do is we'll put information also on our website. And so if you look us up at the Vanishing White Matter Consortium, we have a website since I think today or yesterday. And we'll put information, we'll make links available and literature available so that you can point your doctor to this website. So that your doctor can be knowledgeable in the field, because there is no excuse for not knowing about the disease of your patient.
They really don't know. They was in shock, like in shock.
Yeah, I just see that Priska Leverink, who is also working with us in Amsterdam, put the website address in the general chat.
Okay. And doctor, sorry to bother. It's 10 o'clock. The vanishing did make her. She couldn't walk. She couldn't talk. And neutron is. What is it now?
Neuron.
Yeah. Neuron. Yeah, for Nielsen.
Yeah.
Yeah, vanishing white matter disease. Leukodystrophy. Yeah, because she went for an MRI scan and that. I was in shock because nobody knows about it.
Okay, that's not good.
No, she has seizures. And yeah. And she couldn't walk, she couldn't talk.
I would suggest that your doctor looks at the website. If it's okay, I will answer some other questions as well. And I see an important comment from Angie. And actually, guanabans is not on the market. It's not that you, it's available. So it's only available in, you can, I think, buy it in Sigma or so, animal quality. So we had have specifically made it for the trial. So it's not generally available. Other people's question. Do you understand? Because I find that I find it myself heartbreaking. But do you understand that it's necessary that we set strict trial criteria? I'm coming from the old days, and I think Bob will also remember it. There was this promise for ALD with the Lorenzo's oil and a diet. And because there was such big promise, because with Lorenzo's oil and a diet, the very long chain fatty acids in X-linked adrenoleukodystrophy became normal. So it looked like it was a wonderful treatment. So everybody jumped on it, and there was never a good formal trial. And that means that after many years, it's still undecided. It was no miracle drug. And still after many years, it was undecided whether it does anything or nothing at all. And I think now after many years, people have decided that it doesn't work at all. But that's, I think, almost 40 years later. And I don't want to fall in the same, make the same mistake and do, you know, a sloppy trial or no trial at all and just say, let's all try it. I really want to do a good trial and then be able to say after a couple of years, it works or it doesn't work. And I'm not expecting that. That's also something that we said this afternoon. You know, miracles happen. Yes, I also believe that miracles happen, but typically the miracles that we are different than those that we want. So I don't think that guanabens is a miracle drug. I think it's one step in the right direction. And we see now in Amsterdam that it comes with, you know, difficulty to titrate the patient. So it's not an easy drug, and it's not a miracle drug. So I think it's just one step in the right direction, and we have still many steps to make. Then the compassionate use question. I don't know whether guanabens will be available for compassionate use. I think not right from the beginning, because we first have to become acquainted how the drug is tolerated and what it does. It's not a drug that you can just put in an envelope and then said, okay, here it is, and it's you can try it yourself. Goodbye, because it has too many side effects. And so we first have to get more better acquainted with how the drug works. And then the other thing is, I would certainly want to make decisions about compassionate use together with the whole consortium, because that's not something that can be carried by just one person. I'm certainly not the only person who will say something about it. So it will take time. We have been talking already in the consortium about compassionate use, and the opinions are diverse. Some people are for it and some people are against it. So I think it will take some time.
Okay, Dr. Van der Neep, thank you. There is another question here. Can you please weigh in on the Denali trial?
Say it again?
They're asking about Denali trial.
I'm not the right person to talk about the Denali trial. I'm not aware of a Denali trial in Finishing White Matter, actually. And I think that would be also for Denali to talk about. I'm not aware about, actually right now, guanabens trial is the only trial that's ready. And there are multiple other drugs that are in development, and they take time. There's no such thing as an immediate Denali trial.
Okay.
Are you confident in being able to find 30 patients for the trial? I think we right now we have a waiting list, and we started June 1, and I think that there are, I forgot, 11 or 13 patients on the list. So I also was worried whether we could find such patients, but I'm pretty sure we'll find them. Given the limited number of children diagnosed in the trials criteria, were you able to find 30 children to begin the next round? We haven't found them all yet, like I said, but we found 13 so far, and I think we'll see. We'll see. And if we don't, you know, for the young patients, we mostly might rely on to some extent on new cases. I realize that. And we'll see. We have actually planned 3 years to include patients. So seeing the fact that we have already so many patients now, I'm actually pretty sure that we'll find sufficient numbers. Hopefully. Whether we will make adjustments? Yes, the answer is yes. If we're not able to find the 30 in time, we'll make adjustments. But you cannot just simply define a trial and then just change it. I will definitely have to then to talk to Peter van der Ven, the statistician that you saw this morning. But we already wrote in the protocol that we might need to extend the trial, actually, to make it longer. Are there more questions? I hear a big silence. Is that good or not good?
Dr. Vandernap?
Yeah.
Sorry, I got to go in the other room. This is Jenny Arnold, Jax's mom. I'm wondering if there's going to be a place where you will update the progress of the trial as it's in process.
Yes, I spoke about a committee that we have, and Donna is on that committee. And I think, Donna, we said we'll meet again in December. And also and Brett is on the committee. I see him too. I see other names, I think. The Buck family, I thought I saw. So there are people on the committee, and we'll meet, I think, biannually or something like that, to update everybody. Yeah. And regarding compassionate use, is there a path forward to pursue that? And if so, how long would it take? You know, the only human quality guanabens that's available now is in Amsterdam. So that would be us. And I don't think you can phrase it like that. It's a path to pursue. We are talking about it within the consortium, and there has been not a decision on it. It's not that we say no, but it's not an easy decision. I would say, let's first see how it goes, because we just have the first two patients in the trial. The third patient will be coming soon. And then we can restart in the fall. And let's see how it goes, because I don't know yet. So I think that the compassionate use question for now remains unanswered. Yeah, for time is not our friend. Time is our enemy. I know that. Yes. Yeah. I wish I was some person with a crystal ball. The question is whether I'm able to say if early results have been as positive in the few patients that have started the trial. So the patients have been in the trial only since June 1. So that's very, very short. And so that's impossible to have any results. There are no results. We are just in a titration phase. I think that it would be realistic to say something about tolerance in December. I would be surprised, you know, if we can say something about efficacy in December. So I'm always saying disappointment is not a good emotion. So if you put your hopes too high, you will certainly be disappointed. So if you think that there will be a clinically relevant result after half a year, then you haven't listened to my talk. I'm a little bit strict. Did I tell you that? But I said there are no, that the trials will not be short and they will not be small. So in half a year, we will have a couple of patients in the trial and it will be a short time. So there will be no definitive answer after 6 months. Forget about it. Yeah, I'm not making it more beautiful than it is, because if I would, then you would be mad at me in December or next year, because I would fail on you, because there are no answers yet. You know, you're all looking at me, and if I would be able to work a miracle, I would do it. I've spent my life on vanishing white matter. I sometimes feel I have become Miss Vanishing White Matter or something, you know? Yeah. But it's a burden to carry. It's a lot to carry.
Dr. Vanderkamp, it's good to see you. And thank you very much for all your work. And having been with you for probably 14 years now, since our first daughter was diagnosed, I can say that we have come a long way. When Annie was diagnosed, we felt there was no hope. And so all your work is much appreciated. We feel like, you know, there's hope. At least we have a drug trial now, which we never thought was possible. And they're working on, you know, other drugs or potentially coming up, or compounds. So thank you very much. We appreciate your commitment, which obviously is 100%. And we are excited about the trial and are happy, speaking for the Vanishing White Matter Foundation, very happy to support. And I think it's important probably for everybody to know that between our foundation and the families, Vanishing White Matter Families Foundations, we've committed to support the trial, you know, over 5 years for, you know, close to $600,000 total. So, you know, we're that much committed to it, and, you know, appreciate any fundraising and support that families can do. Obviously, that's very difficult to do, but support either one of our foundations, and so we can see what happens with this trial and see what happens with the others. This one, because you're doing it, you know, really pretty much on your own. There's no drug company that's financing it. You're having to raise the money elsewhere. And we feel like it's definitely worth supporting. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you too. And the trial is really carried by the community, like the Vanishing White Matter Foundation and the Vanishing White Matter Families Foundation contribute a lot of money. Also the ELA supports for a similar amount. And so that's, and donations have been given also to make the trial possible. Without support, we could not have done it. The good effect of it is there's no backlog of financial debt that we have to cover with income generated by Guanabens being on the market. So that's why we aim at making it available if it works at cost price. Because I'm open for that. There may be more effective drugs or one drug might not be sufficient. I'm open for that all. But if other drugs are on the market, there will always be a drug that's relatively cheap. And so for countries where people have not much money, I feel they need to be helped too. So I feel very much that I want to give it back to after that to the community and make it available at cost price. I see some sad people. Ms. Rose, do you want to speak?
I just want to agree with Brett. If for those of us who have been doing this for a long time, this is a far cry from the ULF. If they could see the ULF conference, the first one we went to, was awful. Yeah, Brett's like, oh my gosh. It was really depressing. There was zero hope. Even from you, Mario, there was no hope. So this is just, I think for those of us who have been on this journey for quite a while, this is just enormous. And I think the fact that we're not having to go through the FDA, talking to a lot of rare disease patients and seeing a lot of trials, for promising drugs get stopped. I think this is awesome for our community. This is the best way to get some sort of treatment to the hands of the patients as fast as possible. And for that, yeah, we couldn't be more grateful.
Well, thank you so much for saying that. And I'm not good in giving hope that I don't see. So when we first met, I didn't give you hope because I didn't know that there could be hope yet. I never want to give hope that I'm not sure I can make through.
No, I personally think we've always appreciated that because it's kind of allowed us to live fully, without kind of wrapping Sam too much in cotton wool. And we've actually really appreciated it. Your honesty over the years has been very helpful.
Yeah, I think I find honesty very important because it makes it possible for you to make your life decisions about your family and how you want to deal with stuff. And if I would sell you false hope, that would not be good.
Agreed.
Yeah, this sounds a little bit depressing what we are talking about. In the end, I'm completely hopeful. I'm convinced that in the end, Vanishing White Matter will be cured. And like we said this afternoon, most likely it's going to be a combination of things. And we have the EIF2B activators coming, which I'm hopeful about. So I think that in the end, we'll beat the disease. The thing is, that time is your enemy. Your child is living now, and I understand that. So I'm convinced of a cure, but it's sometimes we're like an oncologist. We are just making steps in the right direction, and it's not that there is a miracle cure of a tumor right away. Has everybody asked and said what they wanted to say? I would say to everybody, help with the registry because it helps. There will be other trials, and it is very important for us to know where patients are and how they are. And so the registry is very important. And as we discussed this afternoon, we want to make it an international. So we hired a person to make it an international and accessible registry so that it's helpful for everybody. And if you have questions, email us. I'm not sure I can deal with all the emails myself, but I have a very helpful PhD student, and hopefully I'll have another very helpful PhD student who helps me with answering the questions. And so we do the best that we can.
So, Dr. Vandernep, what is the best email to reach you? Should the parents, you know, or the families be using VWM registry at amsterdam.umc, or do you prefer other emails to use?
Well, I think that the registry email is wonderful for me because that comes in with the people dealing with the registry, and that takes a little bit of my workload, because the problem is, of course, everybody would like personal attention from me. At the same time, everybody wants me to hurry up and make everything and make the drug available as soon as possible. And that's of course sort of conflicting. And so it helps if you email the registry.
Mm-hmm. So it is the register VWM at amsterdam.umc. That's correct, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I get all sorts of nice emails. I thought you would all be very sad because I'm offering... Ah, Priska, thank you. Priska puts in the registry email. You would all be very sad and perhaps disappointed. So it's a mixed message. There is hope because there's a trial starting, and there will be other trials. Perhaps I should say more out loud. There will be other trials. I foresee trials with EIF2B activators. I think that the inclusion criteria will be different. And I think in the end, all patients hopefully get to be covered. We discussed this afternoon that we are trying to set up this platform trial set up in Amsterdam, so that also trials can run in parallel to make it more efficient. So the field is definitely moving. And if you can bear with me that it takes time, then it's a good development. So what I promise is I'll update the committee, of which Donna, Brett, and the Bucks are part by the end of the year. And hopefully I'll be there at the next ULF meeting. And I've been speaking with Bob, and Bob promised that he would do everything he could to make it a live event next year, so that we can meet and we can sit at the dinner table. And that's also something that I think is very important. And I hope that you also heard the question of Brett and Allison, that they need support in raising the money for the trial. And what else do I forget? Donna, is there a sort of definitive thing that you would like to say?
Other than thank you again for your time. And, you know, and just so you know that we are spreading the word as best as we can about registry and everything. So, you know, so we want to make sure you have the patience, and we want to make sure that the trial is going good. And we're keeping fingers crossed, you know, patient number one and patient number two, they're like families, you know, we are so happy for them, and we're keeping them in our thoughts and fingers crossed that everything works.
Okay, and thank you so much for joining this session, and thank you so much for helping us in many ways, and keep in touch, and we'll try to be as helpful as we can. I would like also to thank the ULF for hosting us, I would say, for and also making the session on the Vanishing White Matter Consortium possible. So it has been a wonderful collaboration over the years. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay, I would say bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Thanks.
Bye. Thanks.